Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Gateway Board of School Directors' regular board meeting. Today is Tuesday, August 16th, 2016. Would we all please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do roll call, Bonnie, please.
Present. Mrs. Cerucci.
Here.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Here.
Mr. Nola.
Here.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Here.
Mr. Ritter.
Here.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Here.
Mrs. Warning.
Here.
Mr. Williams.
Here.
All right, we will turn over to comments from residents on agenda items and agenda items only. We have one that has signed up in advance. Do we have multiple now?
Two. John Yacom and Nancy Lapsovich.
Okay. We will start with Mr. Yacom.
Good evening, members of the board, Mr. President, members of the administration. Thank you for the opportunity to address you this evening. It's nice to be able to address a governing body and have something positive to say. I was asked by Coach Washington, as a parent of a recent Gateway graduate, to speak on behalf, to come in support of the lacrosse program that has been maturing through the Gateway School District. I am a 1983 graduate, and my son is a graduate of, help me out, 2014. I apologize for that. He was able to be on the inaugural team of the Gateway lacrosse program, and with the 4 years that he was at Gateway, he and the program matured together to the point where they began to be recognized as an official team with the Gateway School District. It was always our hope as parents of the organization that the school district would recognize it as and give it its full capacity as a funded varsity sport through the WPIEL. It is my understanding that over the last 3 years, this has slowly and steadily has been occurring. My point of speaking this evening is just to say that the program was extremely positive. My son had opportunities here at Gateway that he would not have otherwise had it not been for that program. Gateway is trying to challenge other school districts, other elite school districts in this county and in western Pennsylvania for students and for new residents. And if you look at the elite school districts in western Pennsylvania, they either have or are forming lacrosse programs. Lacrosse programs are extremely popular within some of our elite universities in the United States, in Canada, and as it turns out, Europe is growing in lacrosse. So this is an opportunity for Gateway to lead. I am very much in favor of academics first. I am very happy the way this board has moved in the last couple of years as to making academics the forefront of the school district. And as a taxpayer, that's most important to me. However, the clubs, the sports, the bands, the choirs, they teach things that the kids can't learn in the classroom. My son is a classic example of that. He learned to follow. He learned to lead. He learned to be part of a team. He learned to put something more important than himself on that field. And every sport does that. Every good coach does that. But the lacrosse program was one more opportunity. The interesting thing about the lacrosse program was that many of the students who played on the lacrosse program were kids that were not getting significant time or adequate playing time in other sports. These are kids that maybe had played football in junior high but just didn't get to be big enough, or played basketball in junior high and then just didn't get fast enough or just didn't get tall enough. I realize that my time here should be very brief. The lacrosse is referred to as the creator's game. The game was played for the creator in front of the creator, and it allowed every one of the creatures that the creator created to play. So the tortoise and the hare both had a role in the lacrosse program. This is an opportunity. I think Gateway is moving in the right direction. I understand that funding has improved from last year, and there has been steady increases in the funding, and I applaud that. And I hope that the school district continues to move in that direction, keeping academics first, but moving toward recognizing the lacrosse program as a full varsity sport with Gateway High School. Thank you.
Trustee Lapsovich?
It's not an agenda.
Not an agenda. Okay, well, we'll get you at the end of the meeting. Do we have anyone else that would like to speak on agenda items? Okay, seeing none, we will move on to Section A, Minutes from Previous Meetings. Bonnie?
Resolved, the Gateway Board of School Directors approves the minutes of the following previously held meetings. Minutes are as listed.
So moved.
We have a motion, we have a second. All in favor? Any opposed? Seeing none, motion passes. Section B, Bills and Financial Reports. Mr. Schott?
Section B, resolved, the Gateway Board of School Directors approves Sections B1, List of Bills, and Section B2, Monthly Financial Statements, as listed in Section B at the Tuesday, August 16th, 2016, regular board meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. Any questions or comments? Neil?
Got a motion. All right. On our reports, the, I don't know, I think you call it the alternate financial report thing.
For which month?
It's called alternate financial report for board.
There's two, and there's a June and July.
This one. Oh, you mean which one?
Yes.
Well, it's actually both, maybe, because what I'm looking for is not on either, so I'm not sure. So here's what I'm looking for. I'll tell you what I'm looking for, and then you tell me how I'm going to get it. When I look at the one, that which is the close of the 1 year, mm-hmm. I see what we budgeted, and I see what we spent, basically. Right? Mm-hmm. And then when I look at the other one, it's the next year, and I see what we budgeted and what we spent so far. But is this closed, or is more things?
There's more things coming. This is a snapshot, as these all are, okay, in time. At this point, we were actually still closing out 15-16.
Right.
We are still paying expenditures, right, through which we basically do 60 days out through the end of the fiscal year through August 31st.
Right.
If anything straggles in after that, we do recognize it for about 5 weeks after that, and also as well as revenue. So I'm in the process of reconciling and pulling all that in. So those beginning fund balance numbers will change from what's there.
Right. So what I'm requesting is I need this one, last year's, every month until you say final.
Oh, yeah. That, and that, now,
like, I don't want to just start getting this new one now, and I need this one.
That's
when it says final.
When you look at the June to the July, that same number as what was previously utilized carries over to that. Once everything is finalized out there, and there'll even be some current year changes that'll even affect that number. But once I have that number, I will report that number specifically to the board.
Right.
So I can say
on this whole sheet.
Basically. Not only on that sheet, right, but also separately to the right board, just to let you know, okay, exactly how we ended fund balance for end,
right,
of 15-16.
I'm seeing discrepancies in these that I believe should be more equal. And I think they will be, actually, I hope.
Well, there's some differences as well as timing differences,
right,
between the two fiscal years. For instance, and just very briefly, there's some accruals that have been made that you're seeing some, and I'll try to keep it simple, there's some receipts that are on the July report that have actually been moved into June because they are applicable to 15-16. I have not done the reversing entries to basically zero those out. So there's some moving parts in there as well.
I fully understand, but I am expecting a final one for last year, and you're going to tell me when I'm going to get it. I prefer it in this format.
Yeah, and that will be updated. Yep.
Thanks.
It's still probably about a month or two out, but
it.
You will have that.
Thanks.
Very good. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Stevenbord.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Very good. Section C, we have no items previously tabled. We will move on to Section D, Personnel Agenda. Mrs. Crump.
Thank you, Mr. Board. Resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors accepts and approves the Personnel Agenda items 1 through 9 as listed in Section D for the regular board meeting of Tuesday, August 16th. August is the busy month for personnel, so we have resignations. We have 9 listed for the district. We thank them for the service and to our children in the district. Transfers, there are 3 listed. We are recalling from furlough two employees, Erin Miner, for a part-time teaching position, and also Debbie Schumitz was a nurse who's being recalled. Leave of absence, we have six listed. Underemployment, we put before you several new employees that we are welcoming to the district, two of which we would like to read their motions. We approve the appointment of Mr. Guy Rossi to perform the duties of assistant superintendent for a term of 5 years through June 30th, 2021, at a salary of $130,000 for the 2016-17 school year, which will be prorated subject to the terms and the conditions of his employment. The second is we want to approve the appointment of Mr. Dennis Chakey to perform the duties of assistant superintendent for a term of 5 years through June 30th, 2021, at a salary of $125,000 for the 2016-17 school year, prorated subject to the terms and conditions of employment. We also have listed three new teachers that will be welcoming to the district, a new nurse, two secretaries, and eight school police officers. Listed before you is also a listing of substitute teachers, food service, substitute aides, substitute secretary, and Keystone testing. We have several volunteers listed, along with supplemental contracts. Section 8 is a salary adjustment for the non-classified employees, and Section 9 is a salary increase for the substitute teachers, approving the increase of the day-to-day substitute teacher rate from $90 per day to $110 per day.
So moved.
Second. Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. Do we have any questions or comments?
I have a
question.
Yeah. Okay.
Neil, do you want to go first?
Sure.
All right, my first thing is this,
and I'm okay with most of these things, but I do know that it's a busy time of year, but we need to start adhering to something here and now, I believe. I don't like seeing the asterisk on these things, especially like I'm looking at number 9. I'm seeing an asterisk where we're changing this. That means it wasn't on the study session, but it was in here. That's one thing. Some of these other things, okay, now I do understand that there are some that we have been discussing, and they just weren't finalized yet. Okay with those. Some we have not discussed. We have not even, this is the first I'm seeing these things, is right now, right here, and for one, I just don't appreciate it being put on at this point in time for these things. Like, I just think that they should either wait, or they should have been texted to me, emailed to me, or something to me. And if whoever's doing it, I don't know who's doing it. I've heard rumors today because I was on the phone with multiple people multiple times, with people talking and... You know, I don't want to say anybody's names, but, you know, different groups of people, board members, administrators, everybody trying to switch these things and move all these things and do all this stuff. I don't appreciate it, because I think the way it should be done is that the board should understand what's going on. We should all be aware of what's going on. We shouldn't be out individually going out and talking to the superintendent about this, or talking to that person about this, or talking to this person about that. It's just my opinion. I think that's a way we are supposed to set a budget, stick to the budget. We're supposed to set a direction for the school district. We're supposed to stick to that direction. We're supposed to have the best education for all of our students with the amount of money that we have, and we're supposed to do that. Whatever that takes to do those things, I'm fine with. The problem is we can't have people going to individuals without everybody understanding and knowing what's going on. You have to, I'm just saying, I don't think that we should be, that's what leads to this, in my opinion. That's what's leading to these things and these changes. All this talking behind the back and all this other stuff that's going on. We don't need any of that stuff. I don't need any, like, I just hear, the bottom line is we hire people, administrators, to administrate. Please allow them to do their job. That's my opinion. Let them go. Let them do what they're supposed to do. I see all kinds of things. I don't want to call out anybody's attention because I'm for, don't get me wrong, I'm for most of these things, actually. I see the lacrosse coach. Fine with that. I really am. I love sports. Sports is one of the things I'm about. But the way that should have went down was somebody, whoever it is, should have meant to Mr. Rivesti or Mr. Murphy, and then they should have went to Mr. Short, and then it should have transpired that way. It shouldn't be other people getting involved and saying when and why. We have a budget process. This is the way we go about it. It should be done at the proper times. When it doesn't get done that way, we run into situations and we have all of this going on, which I'm okay with because I love people to come to these things. But we also have all these amendments to these things, and I'm not for that because I don't think that's the way a district should be run. I think the administrator should stand up for what they believe in, and they should say it, whether it goes contrary to what the board's saying or not. That's the way I think it should be done. Yes.
Can you point out the ones that haven't been brought to our attention in an executive session?
I didn't know.
I mean, you're right about the coach.
I didn't know about the lacrosse thing.
Right.
I didn't know. I mean, if we want to get on to it, I didn't know about the increased pay for the substitute teachers. Technically discuss that?
Yeah, I was, okay, good question. I was going to ask if it was I'm okay with,
like, if we have to hire somebody because we have to hire them to get them in.
Your point is well taken. I'm wondering. So, for example, on the second one, did we budget that? Did we talk about that in budget committee? I, too, don't remember it. Okay. So I'll just ask somebody to clarify that. That we increased the rate from 90 to?
We budget a certain amount that goes through there. What we budgeted on this one when we talked about it in executive session was the increase when this would compensate what we had to pay out for class coverage to each of the teachers. That's where the difference on that was.
Okay, so Neil, help me out here if I'm misinterpreting you, tell me. But I think what he's asking is, okay, we budgeted a certain amount, but were we aware that the apportionment of that total sum was going to result in an increase from 90 to 110? Is that correct?
Yes.
And I don't remember that either.
It would cover in that the substitute teaching budget would go up. However, what we do for class coverages that's budgeted for teachers coming periods would go down. So it balances out.
Don't get me wrong.
No, that's, I think.
I actually am probably for it.
Yeah, me too.
But the answer is, the way it's transpiring to me is I feel like I'm reading part of this. There's other ones in here too. I can name them if you really want me to.
But yeah, I would.
There's other ones in here that I don't like not knowing about them well in advance. Like, we should understand these. I may want to talk to somebody. I may want to go see, you know, the principals about something, or I may want to go see the athletic director about something, or I may want to figure it out. I'm voting on it. Like, that's, you know, I don't have that opportunity.
Neil, could you identify them? Because
I would be happy to.
Yeah, because I think, I mean, I agree with it if they're.
Section D. It's called 1 of 7.
Hold on.
And I'm going based on the key that's on page 7 of 7. There's an asterisk at the bottom of the page.
Wait a minute.
And the asterisk says, indicates addition after the study session. So everything that has a single asterisk, I will read out loud.
Please.
So 1 of 7. Williams, Dawkins, and Hagerich. Did you get that? Williams?
Which item are they under personnel?
Number one. I mean, 1-7. Certain things are uncontrollable, mind you.
1-7, okay.
I have the floor.
All right, I'm with you, 1-7.
There are 3 asterisks on that page.
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to name them.
Right.
Williams, Dawkins, and Hagerich.
Right.
Go to the next page called 2 of 7. There are some asterisks on that page.
There's 1, 2, 3, 4.
You're exactly right. four. Go to the next page.
No. Stay on that page. There's another ad.
Oh, I'm sorry. On section two, that's capital I, that's a two. Under transfers, there's a star in front of the word transfers. That means
all
of these are new. Go to the next page.
I missed that as well.
The very top of the next page, called three of seven, there's three capital I's. That means three. Recall from furlough, that means everyone in that category is a single star, which means you haven't seen it. Now go to the next one. Four, leaves of absence. Okay, the bottom of the page, there are two. Do you see those?
Yes.
Okay, this is the pattern.
Okay.
That, and there are a lot of them.
Yeah.
So we don't have to finish it, but that's how you find out. I mean, that's
the
code that's being used.
And I'm like, some of them you need to do because we've got to get them for school.
Yeah.
Totally understand. Some of them, they should wait till next month.
Yeah.
That's just the way it should go. I guess that's a comment.
All right. So, Mr. President, is there anything we can do about this?
Well, I know Neil has brought up this concern previously. Some of them recall for furlough. I don't think we should prohibit teachers from coming back and hiring teachers that were previously furloughed.
Understood.
I think that's a good thing we should pass.
Yeah.
Right then. So I think there are some instances, the lacrosse coach one, I think everyone here is in favor of the lacrosse program.
Regardless of whether they're in favor or not.
Exactly. But those are things that...
What is the correct process
for
bringing it to the board?
A study session. So okay. I think
and
just...
How do we come up with that salary requirement? Because that's not the number that I was given previously.
I think that number has changed several times. I think that's a...
And that is a prime example of why it should be part of a study session so we can talk about it, not have it thrown in our face the night of a board meeting to vote on with a number when none of us have a chance to research it, talk to the athletic director, look at the athletic budget. I'm not happy about that either.
I'm going to just interrupt there. We have that on a resolution from board agenda from board members. Do we want to bring that up now, or do you want to go... resolution.
Well, no, the pay is under personnel.
She's talking lacrosse, though.
Yeah, the personnel is under, or the lacrosse coach is under personnel.
Correct. Well, Squatty, you or me, it's up to you.
Well, I can address it. I didn't think the lacrosse coach was coming myself. I thought it would be all spring supplementals. The athletic director wanted to post all spring supplementals, and the lacrosse coach, the way they figure that out is through a formula, and being it's a new sport here at Gateway, the athletic director, myself, and Ms. Crum decided to mirror soccer because we're relatively the same thing. And this money here is already budgeted. Yeah. So this isn't
I don't think anyone has any problem with the amount.
Like I said, I didn't think just the one would come tonight. We were hoping that all supplementals were coming tonight so they could advertise them for the coaches to be filled now, because now is when they start their fall conditioning. And in fact, I think that's something that we need to get out there, is all spring supplementals.
They have been posted.
Okay.
I think what Mary Beth is getting at, and I tend to agree with her, is regardless of whether you like the system or not, the way we come up with supplementals, to just inform the public, is a point system. It's a crazy and very complex point system. But number of hours, number of participants, safety factors, all those go into pay. So if you're doing chess club versus coaching football, there's going to be a difference in pay. I think Mary Beth is alluding to, this was just put on now, it wasn't brought up in a study session, so we don't know what that point system was. You had mentioned mirror soccer, but that's not what the point system is made to do. It's made to go through number of hours, number of students participating, etc. So I think overall there's room for improvement. I think there's always going to be room for improvement. I think moving forward we just need to try to get, we have two meetings for a reason. We have a study session so the public can be made aware, the paper can write about it, concerned citizens can show up, but we have also found that even when it's not in the study session they'll show up as well. But if we can get it on the study session, I just think it makes it easier. It allows us time to deliberate. It allows us time to get feedback from constituents, to get feedback from coaches involved, athletic directors. So I think, correct me either of you if you're wrong, but I think that's what they're trying to get at. And I think everyone would agree. Moving forward, we need to try to do a better job of that. Anyone else like that, anything?
Well, there was, you know, one going through here that I was, were two questions that I was going to ask, but one falls in the category that Neil's raising. And, you know, it's the kind of issue that belongs in executive committee, not in public discussion. But it's here, ready for a vote. So, you know, I may be the only one who holds a particular point of view on this particular issue, but, you know, I'd like to have the opportunity to share that with fellow board members, and I didn't know it was coming up either.
You can speak openly about a position if you're not saying the name.
Well, it'd be pretty difficult in this particular case to speak openly and not pretty...
It's already on the
agenda. Yeah, clarify. I don't want to do that. And I don't...
You seem to be struggling with what to do when this happens. I think Neil has articulated it as best he can. You certainly can make a motion to table any individual one of these things at any time. And that might be the way in the future, because again, I don't know what the staff is to do when, for instance, you've got teachers that are furloughed that are coming back, and they can't tell you about it in advance. But you might not like the what you see. You might not like those three. You can always move to table that number, table that issue, table that number, that category, and pass all the rest. So that might be the way you're going to be forced to deal with this until we figure out a better way to anticipate ahead of time. And I'm not sure that the staff's going to be able to do it.
Well, and I think also moving forward, I mean, some of these things that were added, you know, according to board policy, if something is going to be added onto the agenda, it should be given to the president or to the superintendent 4 days in advance. Hopefully that's going to be before the study session again, so that there is at least 2 weeks to go through that. So maybe just adhering to policies that are already in place would help prevent some of that.
Jeff?
Yes?
Can I say something?
Absolutely.
I just want to make sure that the lacrosse people here know that this isn't an issue that we, it's not that we don't support lacrosse, and I think that's probably why Steve's struggling. I don't want to speak for him, but we support lacrosse. We support John. It's the way that this came onto the board and the amounts and the lack of information that we received. Just so it's clear to everybody in this room who's here to support lacrosse, we're not in any way saying we don't support lacrosse. It's more of the way that the agenda and the presentation to the board happened. Just so you guys are aware of that, and that's all I wanted to clarify.
I might be wrong, but I don't believe the salary when we're looking at, I mean, I did, being on the athletic committee, I did sit down with our athletic director questioning some of the salaries of the supplementals. When we looked at the numbers of the supplementals for baseball, the numbers of the kids participating with lacrosse, with the way that it was growing, it actually has more students involved. So when you're looking in the past, and he's much lower than what the baseball coach was, soccer, who doesn't have as many participants as the lacrosse team, then you have to start weighing the facts that, you know, you have a person here. I'm not saying you have a coach, you have a sport that has been existing at Gateway where you had a coach that wasn't paid for several years that was volunteering.
But you can't override the system.
I'm not overriding the system. We're talking. So it has been brought up in the past, and it's always been shut down. So I'm going to say, being on the athletic committee, it was brought to my attention what was going on, and I feel that it was recommendation of the athletic director. Ms. Rivesta, you can correct me if I'm wrong.
Just to interject there, nothing, it was never previously shut down. I mean, this was started, 3 years ago, that it started off very small funding, and we said over the next few years we're going to build a program. So I believe it started at 2, and then it went to 4, and we're up to 8,000. Along those lines, we never provided transportation at first, referee costs, and those have come along as well. So that's just the natural progression of implementing a new athletic program. And then I believe, and either of you can correct me if I'm wrong, but Just this past year, it actually became an official whippeel sport. So previously, it was a club sport.
It's been a whippeel sport for 4 years. And it was the come along each year. Last year, we got cut.
Okay.
You know, in speaking for anybody that would listen, I would talk to in support of when I got here, the first thing I did was, and John can correct me if I'm wrong, was we got to get this, it's a WPL sport. At the time, he had 60 kids on the team.
Excuse me, point of order, for the folks to be able to hear from home, could you go to the microphone and speak, please, so the folks can hear at home?
Louder.
No, the people at home can only hear through the microphone.
At home.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Well, I can't talk on TV.
Come on.
I will do it.
Well, Randy's coming up to the microphone. Something that arose in my committee, and I objected to it and stopped it. Let's just say hypothetically I'm the guy that's applying or that has been chosen for a coaching position, and Scotty feels very strongly that I'm not the person for that job. That conversation should be up and back into in an executive session so that it doesn't embarrass me, doesn't put him in a situation where he has to call me out or something. And I think that's back to the process that's being raised. So
no coach's name.
There is one. No, you're right. Yeah, you're right. So, but in any event, if the salary's new and or the name, I just think it ought to be back there. That's all.
Just some thoughts. I highly support lacrosse.
The numbers dictate that it should be supported. I believe right now it's our third highest in participation behind football and behind track. There's not another sport out there that has more members on it, even with the 40 that they had last year. It's the fastest growing sport in America. I think it's time for us to embrace it, move forward, do whatever we can for the kids, the community, and we want to put this in place so when John Washington is gone, it will survive. And we get one shot at the numbers and one shot at all this stuff, so you have to make it so, well, I want John around forever, and John knows that, and I see guys laughing, and, you know, he gets a little frustrated at times, and this is it. But anyway, any questions?
Question, but not related to this item. We are bringing back Mr. Miner, is that correct? Is that inconsistent with what we did discuss? Okay, that's fine. Good.
And one point that I wanted to bring out, a number of those asterisks that you would see that Mr. Nola was questioning, the process for hiring is very, very complex. A number of sabbaticals, a number of teachers who are taking leave, a number of teachers that we extensively interview that eventually decide, even though we may offer a position pending board approval, then decide, okay, I have another offer, then may take another job. So when it does come down to crunch time, which we are at, a number of these positions, and we have been working so many hours to fill these to ensure that we have the most highly qualified teachers for our children on opening day, and we are not starting with substitutes, that they are in place. So, I mean, I do understand what you're saying, Mr. Nola. It is a process. It's not one that I think anyone is fond of. But when we walk that person to the altar and then all of a sudden they say no, we're starting all over again.
I'm personally fine with the majority of them, actually, except you do have to admit, it doesn't matter if you agree with me or not, but you have to admit that some of these either should have been discussed earlier when we were doing our budgeting time, and or later when after this meeting and to the next month. Like that's what I'm trying to I'm trying to make the process correct. I know why, because I was on the phone a lot today, and I kind of figured out why things got on this agenda and how they got on the agenda. And I don't know everybody who was talking to who, but I heard about some people talking to somebody. And I don't think that that is the process for which things should be placed on the agenda. That's just my opinion. They should be placed on the agenda the way that they're supposed to be, which is through a policy that we have, through that Mr. Steubenbort can read it to you word for word. I'm sure he has it memorized. But that is the way it works. And that's the way we should follow it. And we shouldn't be going around. All I know is, if I have something that I think that anybody on the board should be interested in, I get in contact with them. I either call them, or I email them, or something. I text them, because I think that I don't want to walk in. When you look at our role, the board's role now, I'm talking about the board. When you look at the board's role, the board's role is to not walk into any meeting. Nobody should ever see something that they didn't already hear about and already know. That's my opinion. That's one of the rules. Mary Beth kindly sent me a picture of the page. That's the main rule. You should never blindside another board member in a meeting. And I just feel like that's what's happening to me. And I didn't appreciate it. So just please send an email.
Any other questions or comments?
Mr. Dice, can I ask you a question? If I want to have a conversation with a couple of my board members and somebody else on staff, do I have to have the approval of the president of the school board to have that meeting?
No, you've framed it in a very general way. As long as you keep it to information that you're trying to gather, you're certainly allowed to inquire about subject matter. If, though, the subject of your inquiry is to move towards formal action, then you're going to need the board involved. So you have to be careful. You just realize if you're inquiring, you're trying to become knowledgeable about something, not a problem.
Okay. I was having a meeting last week with a couple of my board members and a couple other people to try to iron a few issues that were out there, and it was shut down because they says it was a safety board meeting. It wasn't a safety board meeting. It was going to be a conversation only. Was I still able to have that meeting?
Well, you need to give me a little more facts.
I can give you the facts on that.
Maybe you can.
What he's referring to is when Chief Cole wanted to have a meeting with the security committee and the superintendent, and they had scheduled that meeting before telling me for a Monday. So I called our head of security, Mr. Key, who was out of town, and said, please do not have that meeting without me. I am the head of security, and I think I should be present if we're meeting with the chief of police of Monroeville. So I agreed, and I deferred to his will because we have hired him to make that decision. Therefore, I canceled the meeting. I left a message for Mr. Cole asking to please call to reschedule that meeting for when Mr. Key could be here, and I am still waiting for Mr. Cole to return my call.
Okay, Mary Beth, I understand Mr. Keyes was out of town, but that wasn't the objective of the meeting, was to just of the safety of the buildings and safety of the children. I was getting black eye from somebody on board, and I wanted to get some answers and correct answers and get this situation ironed out before it went any further, but I was still shut down.
I just think that, here, can I say one thing about it? If you read about the rules about what the board are supposed to do, number four, respect the chain of command and insist that others do too. When an issue comes to us, we should tell that person, this is the person that can fix your problem for you. We don't actually we shouldn't be fixing the problems for them. It's not our role as the board. It's my opinion. You should, if If you need to talk to the superintendent, you can talk to him. If you need to talk to Paul or Trish, you can talk to him. I'm not saying don't talk to these people. What I'm saying is let them do their jobs. If you need to talk to the athletic director, let them do their jobs. Like, there's a chain of command. It should be followed. It shouldn't be the board dictates, because that is not what a good board does. And I'm getting a feeling that we're trying to dictate to people every single thing that we want to happen. We're micromanaging every single thing. It says in here, do not micromanage.
I would agree, but we also digress from the personnel agenda. So I would ask if we have any other questions or comments in regards to the personnel.
Mr. Noll, I appreciate you giving me your okay for me to visit anybody I want to visit. But even if you didn't, this board doesn't understand a few people on this board. When I went onto this board and ran for this board, I says I was never going to let no stone unturned. I wasn't a politician and I wasn't a follower. Some of this board don't like me because I'm bringing up stuff that other board members used to just shove under the carpet. But as long as I'm on this board, there's nothing to be shoved under this carpet as long as I'm here.
Any other questions or comments as it relates to the personnel agenda?
Yes.
Stephanie?
Bonnie, could you please read 5B separately when it's voted upon?
Section 5, employment. I think that a lot of the people that are listening might be wondering why we hired two assistant superintendents and not a curriculum director, and I think you should comment on that before we vote, just to inform the public of why we went that route.
As I mentioned earlier, we went through an extensive interview process advertising for assistant superintendent. We had a number of quality applicants that expressed interest. We went through a series of, I want to say probably five different interview rounds, which also included around with the school board as well. What we found were two quality candidates that have broad, extensive backgrounds into two areas that we were primarily looking for, one of which is an administrator, assistant superintendent currently with the Plum School District, who has been on board there for 3 years. Dr. Guy Rossi, who currently lives in Monroeville, has children in the school district, has extensive background as an administrator in the Pine Richland School District. He has that strong K-6 curriculum background as an elementary principal and assistant superintendent from Plum. We also found through our interview process that we have a strong candidate from the city of Pittsburgh who has also spent some time in suburban school districts as well, Dr. Dennis Chakey. Dr. Dennis Chakey has been a turnaround lead principal at the city of Pittsburgh. He currently is working as the head principal at Perry Traditional Academy. He has a strong background in reform efforts, academic improvement, and what we found were two candidates that truly would mesh together and bring to this district the elements that we were looking for as a district K-12. And we are fortunate that this board was receptive to the idea of bringing both in. And we presented both candidates to the board. They are on the agenda to be voted on tonight. Job descriptions will be sent out to not only the public, but also introduced to our staff upon approval tonight from the board, if they so choose to do so. So that is the reason why we have two candidates on board.
Day start, do you know?
We are currently working with both right now. It is pretty traditional that both, if you have an external candidate, they can be held for up to 60 days. We're working with both to see if that exit plan can be accelerated so they could be on board here at Gateway quickly. And sorry, I will update the board with those dates.
That we should also bring out, and that is that both candidates brought strong curriculum backgrounds, very strong curriculum backgrounds to the table. And Mr. Chakey, brings a culturally responsive teaching pedagogy to the table, which is something that the GAP committee is looking at. So those two elements, I think, also were important.
Extensive training within the city of Pittsburgh over the last 5 years with culturally responsive practices and teaching, and has worked well in a number of neighborhood schools, including being a principal at Oliver High School, prior to that, Carrick High School, and also Perry Traditional High School.
Any other questions or comments as it relates to the personnel agenda?
Are all salaries set for the supplementals that you put out for spring?
Yes.
Okay. So tonight, since we're discussing the salary for lacrosse, that would have been an open salary because there was no set salary.
Correct. Which we used the calculations. Right. Mr. Rivesti and I sat together and went through all the students, the hours, and created the calculations based on the information that he gave me.
So this is just to fill in that empty slot that has been empty for the years?
Correct. It's never been officially on there.
That's why I'm going to say I felt it should be on the agenda for this evening.
Any other questions or comments as it relates to the personnel agenda? Seeing none, roll call, Bonnie, please.
And just before I start, the 5B will be voted on separately. Is that what we're going to do?
Yes.
By request of a second.
So we'll do all, this one will be for all except for 5B.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Yes.
Mr. Nola?
Yes.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Yes, except item number 8. Second name, Mr. Hoffman, no.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbord?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Aye.
Thank you very much. Now we will do section B.
That's 5B. Do we need a separate motion and second on that?
No.
Just roll call. Okay. Very good. Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbord?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
Mr. Williams?
No.
Mrs. Byrne?
No.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Yes.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Aye.
Okay, all motions passed. Thank you very much. We'll move on to Section E, Administrative Resolutions. Mr. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Steubenbord. Under Section E, Administrative Resolutions, resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors approves and authorizes as appropriate the following items 1 through 7 is listed in Section E at the regular school board meeting of Tuesday, August 16th. Item number 1, we have student teachers for the 2016-17 school year, as listed. Item number 2, Eastern Area Special Schools election of officers. And you notice we do have the Gateway representative, Mrs. Stephanie Byrne. Item number 3, Eastern Area Special Schools, the 2016-17 budget, as listed. Also, item number 4, we have facility rentals as listed, and you could see those if you have any questions. Item number 5, exoneration of district real estate tax collectors for 2015-16. Item number 6, approval of maintenance agreement for managed print services with the Wilson Group. And item number 7, appointment of professionals in connection with the issuance of Gateway School District General Obligation Bonds, series of 2016. And I know Mr. Schott had presented information. Do you have any comments, Mr. Schott, about that?
Item, but this is really a continuation of the resolution that was approved at the study session when Piper Jaffrey was named. So basically, this is naming the entire group of professionals involved in the process, consisting of the Piper Jaffrey as the underwriter for the bonds, and Brucey Dyson Associates as the bond counsel for issuance of the bond. So again, just it formalizes all the various professionals involved in the process.
I would just say Pat Neely, who's joining our firm, is here tonight. He's the individual that did your bond issue the last time. Why don't you stand up, Pat, so they don't think that you're just an empty suit. Okay. He's joining the firm, and he was bond counsel with Paul the last time that you did a refinancing. Thanks, Pat.
Very good. Do we have a motion?
Second.
A motion and a second has been made. Do we have any questions or comments?
Just one.
Val?
For the last one.
Yep.
The bond?
Yes. Did you bring the pens? They were supposed to bring pens to go with the
He's not with Piper Jaffe. He's with Bruce.
Okay. Well, I just wondered. Okay.
No. Nope. Let me tell you. You're going to get a pen.
Okay. Thanks. I just wondered.
I'm going to see to it she gets a pen.
It'll only be Val.
We have any other questions or comments on Section E?
Can we go on Section 2 separately? No, I'm just kidding.
Anything else? Seeing none, roll call, Bonnie, please.
I'm going to have to vote no on the last one.
Because Bruce isn't going to give me a pen.
I'm going to give you a pen.
Oh, okay. That changes everything.
That's it.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbord.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye, except for number two. I'll give you a double aye.
Okay. Is that everyone?
Section F.
Okay. We'll move on to Section F, resolutions presented by board members. And Val, if you want to take the first one.
Resolution that the Gateway Board of School Directors approves and authorizes as appropriate items 1 and 2 as listed in Section F. Resolutions presented by board members at the Tuesday, August 16th, regular board meeting. Number 1, Monrovia Volunteer Fire Company. Number 4, Emergency Medical Services Ambulance Coverage Fees. For the board, approval fees to be paid to Monrovia Volunteer Fire Company. Number 4, to provide standby emergency medical services. Ambulance coverage at Gateway High School, varsity football games, and various sporting events as depicted in Exhibit D. The reason why we're voting on this is there has been an increase of $25 from the previous year for to have an ambulance sitting at the football games, the junior high games, the soccer games, lacrosse games, that they're there. This is just to make sure that we have coverage. And I. Well, I'm going to say that we've had number 4 for how many years, Mr. Avesti, that you can remember?
I don't know the answer to that, but it's been
a long time. About 13, 14, 15 years.
Since 93.
Okay.
This is the first raise.
Yes, since 93.
We're talking $25 from what I understand. We could count on them if there was an ambulance that was needed. It was there as soon as the ambulance left, say, whether for somebody in the stands, whether it was somebody on a football field, soccer field, lacrosse field, the ambulance was there.
Just,
and
just
it
the
went.
Football field.
Just football field.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. But we're talking $25, and okay. I just wanted to have it that it was approved so there would be no other questions. We haven't had any problems in the past with them. I would just like to keep it that way.
All right. I'm eventually going to move to table, and I'll kind of speak as to why. So there was, for BLS, or basic life support, there's an increase of 50% to the cost, and for advanced life support, there's a 25% increase to the cost. The reason that I will make a motion to table is simply because we had budgeted for the other amounts. To my recollection, I went back last year, we've never actually approved a fire company individually. It was through the athletic department to make sure an ambulance was there. So I would just recommend that we table this, that we reach back out to four, see if they'll agree to the budgeted amount that we had already allocated, and if not, reach out to other fire departments in Monrovia. So if you're familiar with Monrovia, it's all under one EMS. It's Monrovia EMS. So there are multiple fire departments that have their own ambulance, but it's all under one EMS charter. So I would just like to see if we can save some money and stay at those costs. And if not, I don't see a problem.
We have a game August 26th, mm-hmm. a football game. All right, what happens August 26th? We don't have coverage?
Well, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that we should look at it and see if we can get coverage provided for 25 to 50% less.
Okay, when will this take place if we just discussed that we should have everything, whether it's an executive session or study session, which we will not have prior to an August 26th game? when would that take place?
So we've already voted on and approved, as the ambulance service was already included in the athletic department's budget. So if we can find a fire department, or if number four agrees to going down 25 to 50% on their services, we wouldn't have to vote on or change a single thing. It's already been approved.
Mr. Schott.
I can verify too. I'm specifically, it's not in the spirit of the zero-based budgeting, you will not find a line item in the 16-17 budget that says ambulance service for that. We actually, based on and board member inquiries, looked into our accounting system where we list every vendor. I could not find any payments to either Municipality of Monroeville or Monroeville Volunteer Fire Company number four that we've made to them. So to the best of my knowledge in the system, we've never made a payment to them that I was able to discover for that.
Thanks for telling them.
So to be clear, we've had number four for a number of years. They haven't raised their price in 23 years, and they haven't charged us either within the last few years.
Correct.
That's probably a good estimation.
Okay.
So is this a contract,
or is this just a one-time approval? I'm not even understanding, because, again, this is the first time I'm seeing this, too. So we haven't had a chance to really discuss this or understand this, so I would motion to table it.
Okay, so wait, I thought you made the motion to table it.
She just made the motion.
Can we untable this after we table this?
You can.
Of course.
Once a motion to table is made and a second is made, there is no longer any debate. Chad pulled kind of a smooth move, and he talked about tabling, but he didn't make the motion to table and discussed it.
Gotcha.
Once Mary Beth made the motion and it got seconded, that ended debate.
Gotcha.
You can get it out of the table, though.
Unless you don't get five votes.
Right.
Well, yeah. If you don't get five votes to the table, it doesn't pass.
Gotcha. Okay.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbord.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
No.
Mr. Williams.
No.
Mrs. Byrne.
No.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Yes.
Mr. Lapsevich.
No.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell?
No.
Motion fails.
All right, so the motion failed, correct, Lonnie?
That's correct.
Okay.
That is correct.
So you can keep talking about it.
Feel free to talk away.
I think that we'll end up just getting whomever. We should just go to whomever and ask them how much they would do it for.
Okay, again, the public thinks we're figuring out $25, but it's
the point that we have 25 to 50% increase. We were never told about it. It shows up on the agenda tonight, and we are responsible for managing your money. Do you want me to just vote anytime for a 50% or a 25% increase without questioning it, without researching it, without anyone else seeing if they can match that price? I'm responsible for being a good steward of your money, and that's the point that I'm trying to make here. I'm not trying to bicker, because I have a lot of friends at Monroeville No. 4, and I like Monroeville No. 4. There's a lot of great firemen there that I know personally. So let me just say that. Again, it's the principle of the thing here that we're talking about.
Mr. Dice, can I make a motion to vote on this?
Certainly.
Okay. I vote to...
To accept
number four's
that's
services at,
yes,
at all our whatever games, wherever they are.
There's a motion on the table.
Is there a second?
There's a motion. There's a second. Any questions or comments? And I would just like to say that this meeting has definitely digressed. But I would just like to say I am a member of Monroeville Volunteer Fire Company number one, and it's nothing against four. It's nothing against any fire department. I just think, as Mary Beth alluded to, if we can receive any services for anything, adequate and equal services for less cost, I would expect that as stewards of the budget, we would do so. So that is my reason. It's not anything personal. It's not anything to go after anyone. It's simply to say, here's the cost. If we can get it for less, if we can get pencils for less than our budget for, I would hope that we would go for the less expensive and equal pencil. So. There is a motion. There's a second. Any other questions or comments?
My comment is I'm just concerned you have a game August 26th. if we don't have something in place August 26th, something happens, what do? They're stranded. So it needs to be...
Will come out here and give us an ambulance service for one night if we don't make this decision tonight.
Who knows? And you might have someone charging you more. At least we have a definite price. We know they're going to be there. They've been there for how many years? We've never had a problem with them. Why even deal with it?
Or they haven't charged in the past.
Yeah. And I got another, not a question, but I have a comment that I've heard that the chief on number one does not want to participate at any of our games. So...
I would ask that we don't bring people that are not present into this conversation.
Okay, but
especially as
I
just
tell
talked
you.
To them previously.
Okay, whatever. But we need a vote.
Okay, there's a motion. There's a second. Any other questions or comments?
I'm just clear that we're voting on item number one, section F. Correct.
Correct. Okay. Bonnie, roll call, please.
Mr. Sittenbort.
No.
Mrs. Warning.
Yes.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mr. Cerucci.
No.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
No.
Motion carries.
Very good. Motion passes. And we'll move on to number two, and I do not know who added that on to whoever.
I'll move that we override ready for motion on item number two.
We can do
I'll
that.
Move that we accept the estimated cost of $8,800 for lacrosse uniforms.
Second.
Motion on the floor. We have a second.
Any questions? Discussion, please.
Let me get a second question. Hey,
it has been approved by the WIPIAL. We have a Nike contract. All sports at Gateway use Nike uniforms, all equipment. Lacrosse is using Under Armour. They're not under contract. I mean, we need to put them under contract with the Nike. And from what I'm understanding, our athletic director has reached out to Nike to see if they can maybe help us in some way. That this might not be a cost, but we're just asking for that amount, just being researched.
Okay.
And this is on.
I have a few things. I'll
do
start.
Do we still have a Nike contract?
Well, that's what I'm going to do. Do you have the Nike contract in hand? Because I'm looking at it right now, and it expires in May of 2016.
Yeah, I inquired.
And also, not to cut you off, Randy, but... if you read the sections in here, it only alludes to football.
But it does give us a 40%
discount.
Reduction of RSP.
So we're on a four-year cycle with uniforms. How many years has it been since lacrosse had new uniforms?
We bypassed football because theirs were in good shape. They should have been on the agenda for this year because they were good, and that was in the back. We had a lot of 25,000, and because that I didn't feel there was a need, because they're in good shape, we moved to backs.
So you're asking to take the football budgeted money and move it to lacrosse?
It was on last year's budget at the end, the cycle of uniforms. And so when it came to this year to either purchase it or not, I just took that out and moved it over. Moved it out to 8 years or 4 years from now.
And this is in addition to the 8,000 we budgeted for already, is that correct?
That is
so
correct.
The public is clear. So we're asking for $16,000 for lacrosse?
That is correct.
And did anybody answer the question on when lacrosse got their last uniforms, please?
4 years ago and 5 years ago, respectively.
Thank you.
I do have a few questions, I guess, since this is being brought up. On the document, John, that you had prepared, there is $5,175 allocated for uniforms. And this is a motion for $8,800. And I was wondering, what is the discrepancy there?
Well, there was a completely different brand. We have off-brand, well, they're Brian uniforms that I purchased with booster money. Mm-hmm. 4 years ago. So this will be our fifth year using that. Wait, I'm sorry. We've got 5 years of using it. This will be our sixth year using it.
Okay.
So I paid $45 a shirt, $25 for shorts.
So just changing the uniform is the discrepancy.
I shopped around and got the cheapest thing that met the WPIL requirements.
Okay. So just an upgrade. Okay. I guess the other question I would have then is, in an email, it says in 2016, equipment is only given to five or six players. Everyone else had their own stuff. For next year, I wouldn't really need much in the way of equipment. Does that still stand true? And if so, are we able to move some of that equipment money over and then just pay the difference for the uniforms?
What we need to do is this, number one, we've got to find out. In football, you're allowed to use a helmet for up to 10 years, and regardless of what kind of shape it is, you have to get rid of it.
Correct.
Some helmets are flat, some do not come back from reconditioning.
Correct.
What we want to do is get in a position to where we're not hit with the need for 40 helmets. Now, what we're going to say is the kids now have to purchase their own, so a lot of them do have it. The plan is to buy 16 sets of stuff so that we start to transition in. So in 4 years from now, or 3 years from now, or when the kids aren't here, and they might be sad to hear they're not getting new stuff, it would be for the kids who don't have, so that they can. But the upfront cost is, expensive. So we want to transition it in for 4 years. And it's an estimate. We're hoping the uniforms come in less than that, but we don't want to come back. I don't want to come back in 2 months and say, hey, we need another six. We're trying to do it right the first time.
And I guess my biggest confusion, why I'm upset, and it's nothing against the lacrosse program. I believe it from last year's numbers, the team, and there's a lot of you guys here, had the second highest GPA as far as athletic teams. So that's quite impressive. You better work harder. As a school board member, I love to see that. I think that's great for Gateway. As Mr. Yacob alluded to earlier, that a lot of great schools have this. A lot of surrounding school districts that we try to be and try to, outpace, exceed, have lacrosse and have successful lacrosse teams. It was their first year or second year where they made the playoffs. Second year as a club sport with minimal funding made the playoffs. That's impressive stuff. So I would hope there's no one up here that is against lacrosse, because as far as what it's doing for the students, it's great. I guess my only concern is, we went through a 6-month budget process, and anyone that's on the board remember those very, very long meetings where, we switched to zero-based budgeting this year and literally went line item through line item.
8 months.
8 months, sorry. So I guess my question was, why weren't these things addressed? Because now we're facing, we have $8,000 in there for equipment, and that's all that the line item says. If you look at some of these other line items like football, it'll say this many rolls of tape and this many helmets and this. Whereas.
Tell her to put in $6,000 for a coach to get approved, and it's not approved yet.
Yeah, I don't have any problems with the coaches.
No, it has nothing to do with
it. I just think the equipment line item, and now we're going to approve up to $8,800 for uniforms, and we're saying, we might not use the $8,000 for equipment, right? If you're saying 16 helmets, the sheet that I was given, right, helmets are at 100.
Shoulder pads.
Yeah, the whole, we'll call it whole get up, is it about $400 a kid, $300 a kid actually. So that number is going to be a little off. So I'm just asking, if we're under budget, are those dollars going to be returned? Because my guess would be the dollars would be spent. So just looking at zero-based budgeting, I would just ask that moving forward, we stick to zero-based budgeting. We have line item to go through, and that way we can have these discussions prior, as opposed to we've already approved a budget, and now we're getting into this downhill spiral of adding expenditures after. So it's nothing against the program. It's nothing against the jerseys. I just, from the budgetary standpoint, I wish we would have evaluated this earlier.
There's nobody trying to sneak something in or trying to do anything behind your back or anything like that. Yeah. Let me finish. This has been a sport that we promised a couple years ago we would make full-fledged. And over the years, some things that come up and we forget about them, or the budget gets tight, or this or that or that. And you ask why this hasn't been done. I commend you guys. We had everything done except the uniforms. And it was maybe an oversight by Randy and myself. But in June, when we were in here meeting to discuss hiring maintenance people and stuff like that was brought up, and it said, you know what, we don't have time for this right now. It's a spring port. We can do that later. And that was in June, and that's when it should have been done. And because of distractions, again, it didn't get done. That's okay. And the $8,000 here is for a midline shirt, you know, a black shirt, a white shirt, and just one pair of shorts, not two. And it's you know, we talked to Nike. They might be able to help with some. They might not. They might help. You know, we don't know. Just like the email that Mary Beth sent out about the tasers. You're looking for grants. And that's what we did. We asked. And we're hoping, and we're pretty sure it will come below this. And we didn't want to have to come back and beg the school board for more money or anything like that. And like I said, we're not trying to hide anything or sneak stuff in or stuff like that.
And I don't think you are. I just wish this would have been addressed earlier, because it just sets a bad precedent moving forward. You know, now the golf team might say, well, they got new stuff. Maybe we need new golf bags. Or baseball team might say, we don't have any equipment. Maybe they'll buy us bats and gloves now.
Well, again, this is a new sport. We've never been down this road, you know, with these new sports and directing things out.
It's
a spring, so in the spring it comes. You know, that's why you got to name coaches now and try to get things done.
Yeah,
like I said, there's no secrets or trying to pull the wool over somebody's eye or sneak something in. If you guys think that, I apologize. You know, I would never try to do that. And it was just, you know, they have been put down or as the stepchild that's pushed away, you know, we're trying to bring them in and show them some love.
Yep.
That's all.
I mean, just personally, I'm voting for it because I think that it's what we should be doing. That being said, when we get back to our principles, we need to understand that there's an order and a procession of the way things get done. And we should have done this a little sooner. I'm going to side with Chad on that side because we should have known about it. We should have thought about it and did it. We didn't. That's okay. I'm voting for it. I'm okay with that. But I think we need to all, on all of these issues, work to do a better job of planning and foreseeing what's going on. Like, that's what the budget process is for. but I'm all good with it. I'm just saying, I think we need to work on that, because when we see all these things coming in, it's just, you know, there's going to be a point in time when we don't have money. Yeah. We don't have an opportunity to do these things.
Sure. See what goes on.
Are there any other questions or comments?
Go ahead.
Steve?
Oh, come on, Steve. You don't even have your button on. Go ahead.
We've spent probably the last half hour on, if you do the math, 0.00012% of our budget.
Right.
Come on, guys. Let's vote it.
Right.
Well, and I guess I would just rebut that by saying we also spent...
Chad, you're going to rebut it every time I raise it. That's all I'm saying is...
Come on,
let's vote it.
I would say that... We do need to have procedures in place. I mean, if we don't, then we're just going to add everything.
Of course, but everything's not going to come to the table. When that phrase is used all the time. Budgets are best estimates at the time we draw them up of what it is we expect we can receive in revenue and what we expect to expend.
I guess my concern...
Let me finish, please.
Yep.
When you go through these processes, like starting up new programs or starting up the safety committee programs, or other programs of that sort, expenses are going to arise that, despite the best efforts of everybody around this table and all the administration, we weren't able to anticipate. This is such a small expenditure that it I don't want to say it doesn't warrant our dialogue, because it does, but keep in mind what it represents, 0.00012, okay, of our $72 million budget. So it's a budget. It's not the Ten Commandments.
I agree with you, except for I sat in budget meetings, and members of this board argued and fought and fought and fought and fought about $2,000, $1,500 about for certain positions doing this and certain positions doing that. So we had board members fighting for that. It's the procedural part of it. I'm for this. I'm like one of the biggest guys for this.
Okay,
but
then
I'm
we take
you,
a vote.
I'm telling you that when you try to trivialize it like you just did, that's not fair and it's not right. Because that's not appropriate, because when we were going through that budget process, there were people on this board that were fighting over $1,000 numerous times.
It may not be trivial or what did you say, right, but it's an accurate statement. That's what it is, okay?
But don't sit there and say it's this percent of the budget, but when it's your opinion, you have this own thing.
Well, that's take personal tax out of it.
Yeah.
Any other questions or comments?
Yeah, I do.
George.
Mr. Nola, yeah, we were nitpicking $1,000, $2,000 for different employees, but it's we had the right to because some of the issues were adequate enough to bring up and discuss. It wasn't that we were going to try to save $1,000. Some of these issues weren't shouldn't have been given to certain individuals, but Mr. Washington been working for 5 years on his own, not getting paid, the whole nine yards. So whatever he needs, you know, I'm 100% behind him.
Very good. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call. Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Warren?
Yes.
Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Yes.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Yes.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Aye.
Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Stubenbort?
Aye.
Do we have any other resolutions, Board members?
I do. I have a resolution.
Members
of the Safety Committee got together and met with the recently hired chief and the others that we put together. And they brought forward a list of items that we had not considered at the time we formulated the budget. And at the end of the day, they asked for an additional $18,000, not to exceed $18,000, for various items. And my understanding is they're going out and shopping these now. But for purposes of being completely transparent, I'm going to move that we authorize an expenditure up to and including $18,000 for the newly formed police force for uniform and equipment requests as the safety committee asked.
Second.
Thank you.
There's a motion, there's a second. I'll start with just a question and comment, and I agree. There are things that came up, and I am in support of that. I just want to clarify a few things that some expenditures also went down significantly, including the cost for tasers went down $6,000. So we're really looking at about net $3,000 to $4,000 after all said and done. And it was budgeted for elsewhere, so it's actually just allocating some of that money. So any other questions or comments?
Well, I'd be in the frugal person that I am with your tax dollars. I would be in favor of changing that to about $6,000. And if they exceed the $6,000, then we can revisit it. I don't feel the need to dish out the full $18,000 because I'm not certain we're going to need it all, and I don't want to put all that money on the table if it's unnecessary.
So, are you making a motion to amend and just purchase the uniforms?
Well, I'm just opening up for discussion.
Okay.
Okay. Question. Comment.
Yep.
If they need something, all right, are they going to come back? Just hypothetically is what we've been discussing. Are they going to say, okay, we need this much more? Does that mean we're going to get together as a board and say, okay, or Chad, are you going to be calling around saying, do you approve this? Are you going to go with this? Is that what's going to happen? Or would it be best just to put the amount that Steve is saying, if they don't need it, then the money comes back?
Right. That's essentially, that's it. A simple process. Approve it. It all has to be authorized. It has to be signed off on by the superintendent. Yeah. If it comes in at a dollar, remember I said not to exceed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
If it comes in a dollar volume, significantly less than that, comes in less than that. But we don't have to dicker with, you know, metal badges or nylon inner belts.
Yeah.
Well, and you don't have to call
it running for. But yeah, I would say
that's all.
It is going to be less than that. But right. To Val's point, I would say as the expenses come up, they can come. We actually, in the security budget, there is a line item for ancillary expenditures, which includes some of those costs, so and that's for $36,000. So,
but this was over and above those numbers because they already had that budget.
Well, there's some ancillary services that aren't needed.
I'm just saying the original budget that they had did not include these items. They brought them back in front of
correct.
Us. We discussed it at length. And I'm just saying, let's approve up to $18,000 and be done with it so they can start school fully equipped.
Yeah, I think Val just brings up a good point that as that expenditures come, they represent it to the board. So even though we're approving this, you know, as the sheriffs and pants just have the purchase order on here.
But that's why we have a superintendent. We approve the $18,000. He has to sign off on each and every purchase order.
Correct. I have been meeting with our police. Mr. Shaw could probably provide a better update as far as expenditures at this point, real quick.
But honestly, I don't need an update. This is just simple. We met. We discussed it in detail. This is what they asked for. We said it was reasonable. We agreed for purposes of transparency to put it on the table. If between you and the chief, mm-hmm. it ends up at $2,000, hallelujah. But okay. Let's just be all done right. with
is
it
there a second, then?
Move on.
There was a motion. Yes. There was a second. Was there any other questions
all right,
or comments?
Go to vote, then.
Mr. Schott, well, I'd like to hear from you first, and then I have something to say.
If I just make one brief comment, is there currently is, in Mr. Short's
budget, $28,000 that was not earmarked specifically for any particular items, but it was under safety items. And again, that would be above and beyond the original $36,000 that was originally budgeted for equipment. So essentially, if this resolution be approved, what we would do in October when we can make budget transfers is transfer the necessary amount from those from that line item that's there to this particular account to take care of this. So again, this is just reallocating monies that's currently in the 16-17 budget. It's not overspending the budget. I just wanted to make that comment. That, again,
so we're not taking it out of reserves.
So the correct. Public knows it's just a just reallocation from Mr. Short's security to
somebody else's.
Okay.
Listen, this is for purposes of transparency.
Yes. Right.
Okay.
That's why I'm clarifying.
They came to us. They said they needed $18,000, up to $18,000 of additional equipment. We had a long discussion. You were there, Chad, George, myself. We basically said, you know, we're getting up at 8 o'clock in the morning to nickel dime a brand new police force over, you know, a metal badge or something of that sort. We want them to be properly equipped when they begin the process. We have checks and balances internally with Mr. Schott and the superintendent. They gave us a list. We said, okay, I think that the community needs to know that that's all. It's a transparency issue. We have this budgeted amount. Now we're going to spend up to another $18,000. Where we get the money from is another issue. But that's what the starting, what it looks like the starting budget is going to look like now, plus $18,000.
Scotty mentioned too, we're soliciting
sure.
grant money for some of these items. Which
sure,
we
I saw a
end
note
up
from
offsetting
you.
That because we really do want to stay
yeah.
within budget.
Yeah, absolutely.
Can I just make a comment? I know there's
a lot of. Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. Go ahead, John.
Thank you very much.
I think I like Steve's approach here. In other words, we're giving the new team a vote of confidence, understanding that they are starting from scratch, and you have to have some bucket to start with in order to get the ball rolling. The first time the initial purchases, and we wouldn't want to put our new police force in a position of having to nickel and dime and worry about buying tasers first and shirts and then hoping to buy pants, you know, 6 months from now. They're more professional than that. They know what they need in order to keep the school safe. So offering them this bucket of money with governance, I think, is the proper role for this board.
I was just going to say exactly what John says. It's a startup process. It's just like what we just discussed with lacrosse. It's a startup. They get their things in. It's not going to cost us every year this amount of money. It's going to be the initial startup. So I think everybody is on the same boat with that.
Any other questions or comments?
Take the vote.
Seeing none, we'll do roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrd.
Yes.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Yes.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Aye.
Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell?
No. let me change that. Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Well, aye.
Mr. Steubenbord?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
John, thank you. You said that
very good.
Far motion. Better.
Very well said, John.
Motion passes. Any other resolutions presented by board members this evening? Seeing none, we'll move on to comments from residents on non-agenda items. Do we have anyone that would like to speak? Nancy had signed up in advance. If you could just please state your name.
Bill. First thing I want to say, since I have the TV here, any graduates of 1966 in the listening area, we will be having our 50th class reunion. course, they were all older than me at the time, but get in touch with one of your classmates. It's September 9th, 10th, and 11th. We're going to need the whole weekend. Going to party. After 50 years, we deserve it. Second comment, at the last meeting, I told you I'd be back, and I am. You know that it's a stamp mandate, state mandate, that we have Narcan in the schools. The government's approved, or the governor's approved it. The state of Pennsylvania's approved it. I just wanted to know if the board has come up with a policy for it. Mr. Steubenbord.
Yes. So we've spoke several times about this. So
yes.
I guess just to inform the public, it's not a mandate, but it was approved that Narcan can be used in the schools by non-first responders. So a policy is out there. We had our nurse, our head nurse, looking at it. She has since resigned, or retired, actually. So at next month's meeting, we will actually have a new designated head nurse who will look through that. The physician has already given it the okay.
Good.
So we just need our nurse now, whoever the new head nurse will be, to give it the okay and present it to the board. From there, it's up to the board to decide who actually is able to administer the Narcan. So it could just be the nurses. It could be nurses and police officers. It could be nurses, police officers, teachers. We can include staff. So there are several different ways to do it, and every district around us is doing it a different way. Some haven't done it at all, but you know, to your point, and you've brought it up several times, I think it is a great thing to have. Hopefully, we'll never ever open a box of Narcan.
Absolutely, but now with the new police department, if the nurses don't feel,
if we can have it on hand,
they want to give it. If they're not in school that day, the police officers will be more than qualified.
Yeah, if we can have it on hand, I think it's great. So it's going through the pipeline. We're really at this point just waiting for our nurse to be. Other than that, everything else is out there. So
okay. The
physician has said, okay. The training we have available for free. The nurse just needs to look at it, make a few suggestions, and then present to the board on that.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome, Nancy. Would anyone else like to address the board? Mr. Washington. If you could please just state your name for us.
John Washington, 113 Glenwood. I just wanted to thank all of you for what you've done for La Crosse. I'm sure my son would thank you, but he's off in college now. We're starting off our seventh year. This has been a great experience. I think I've done a good job, but I've been really fortunate, and I want to thank all of our players, past, present, and future, our parents, our boosters that have been so supportive. We've been very patient, we've been very understanding, and we appreciate you recognizing us as a full varsity sport, and we will make you proud. And I invite you to come see us play sometime. You know where to find us. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Position.
Oh.
Since stop.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Any other, or would anyone else like to address the board this evening? Seeing none, we'll move on to administrative reports. Mrs. Crump.
Thank you, Mr. Steubenbord. We'd like to welcome all of our new employees to the Gateway family. We're excited to see our teachers come back on Tuesday and our paraprofessionals on Friday. We're excited about a new year. We also want to thank all the administrators and the secretaries and the custodians who've worked all summer to prepare us for the new year to get started off right.
Thank you very much, Mr. Schott.
Nothing further. Thank you.
Very good. Mr. Short.
Number of items, not to replicate what Mrs. Crump said. However, with our resignations, just thank you for all of the years of service to the Gateway School District for all of our employees who are retiring or moving on. Also, would like to acknowledge the administration did send out a letter to our University Park parents notifying them that Mrs. Jennifer Hoffner will be taking over as the building principal K through 4. It was noted in the board report, the agenda tonight. And Dr. John Fournier would be returning back to Gateway High School, where he was previously the assistant principal for 4 years. Also, very excited and just thankful for the board in welcoming Dr. Dennis Chakey and Dr. Guy Rossi onto our administrative team. They can't wait to get started to meet everyone within our community, and I think you would find them very welcoming and receptive and open door policy and really eager to get to learn our community and our culture here at Gateway. Also, reminder to our parents and students, Skyward, beginning tomorrow, schedules will be posted. It is that time of the year. This would be for grades K through 8. Those family students, I'm sure at midnight tonight, will be checking, hitting the button on Skyward to see their schedules posted, along with, I believe, bus information. I know Mrs. Isha has been hard at work with that. Is that correct?
Yes.
Thank you, Mrs. Isha. High school schedules, the counselors are doing a few tweaks. They will be posted on the 23rd for our high school students. And we look forward to our staff returning on August 23rd for our three-day in-service activity. And also just a shout out to our custodial maintenance crew for doing a fantastic job. The buildings look great. What you're seeing now is the exterior of those buildings, a lot of landscaping coming together. So you will see a number of our folks going outside and working on the grounds. That's all. Thank you.
We'll move on to board reports. Mr. Williams.
I'd just like to welcome everybody back to school, employees, children, kids. Watch school buses. Be safe. And that's all I have tonight.
Very good. Mr. Ritter.
Sure. Three things. The new school director training is being offered by the PSBA. That's the Pennsylvania School Board Association. They had a virtual session last Thursday, and the second of the two parts will be held this coming Thursday at 5 p.m. So it's new school director training for the new folks on the board. Number two, I'm putting together a meeting with the National Association of School Nurses through Health Level 7 International, which is a standards development organization, in Baltimore in September 2016. This is at no cost to the school. This is the other hat that I wear as a volunteer with HL7, a standards development organization who works on electronic health records. So the goal will be to collect the requirements from the certified school nurses so that we can find a way to use technology to increase the ability of the school nurses to be able to do what they do better using technology and care for the students and make sure that it's done in a minimal, cost-effective, safe, standards-based way with complete security. So I'm going to be interviewing those folks from the National School, NASN, National Association of School Nurses. So that will be in September. The third thing is the students and the staff will be returning to school soon. Members of our community have taken it on themselves to meet near the entrances of all schools in our areas on Saturday, the 27th from 9 to 10 a.m. near the front of any and all schools. And so they list all the schools as being Franklin Regional, Gateway, Kiski, Penn Hills, Penn Trafford, Plum, Woodland Hills, high schools, elementary schools, private schools, any schools. So this is put together by the parents, the members of the community. So I think it would be silly for people to meet and pray if God didn't answer. I think it would be silly for us to not go and pray if God did answer. So I'm going to go. That's all I have.
Very good. This is Sirici.
I would like to welcome Mr. Chakey and Mr. Rossi as our new assistant superintendents, and just say that I'm impressed with the quality of the candidates, and I'm very excited that we're putting some great leadership back at Gateway. I think we're really moving in the right direction. I think that the teachers and the parents will be happy with what they see this coming year. I'm happy about security. We're up to 11 staff already, and the individuals that are applying are above and beyond what I've expected. And you'll continue to see that continue to grow. To the lacrosse players, I support you. I hope you bring home a championship. You got to listen to a lot of bickering by grown-ups about budgets and numbers, but just so you know, we do support you. I support you being a school-sponsored team, absolutely 100%. And congratulations for all your hard work, and I hope you have a great season. Thank you.
August 29th, parents, back into your regular routine. Kids will be back in school. Students, make sure you get to bed early on the 28th. We can try that at least. August 26th, Gateway's first home football game against Woodland Hills. We haven't played Woodland Hills in several years. It's always been a rival. We're coming back into our regular, I guess, section where we had the Penn Traffords, the Plums, everything that I think you're going to see a more, hopefully more school spirit that we've had in the past. Mr. Avesti, I know we have been a pain, but thank you for putting up with me asking a lot of questions about what we've just dealt with tonight. Mr. Washington, hopefully you will get the position again, and good luck with lacrosse, and to all the lacrosse players and parents with the support. I'm just saying, good luck this year. We're here to help you. Don't ever think we're not supporting our sports teams, any of the teams, the clubs, anything. That's what the board's here. Sometimes we just, I guess, new on the board, need to learn some things, the way things go, but I'm one to push for things, and I want to see things done. So best of luck to you. Also, for anyone wanting to rent or use any of the facilities at the school, make sure you go on to School Dude. It's on the website to set aside to sign up for facility rentals so there's no problems. One quick question, talking to the technology department, they already have problems with teachers, faculty, staff. Coming to them directly, you need to go on to technology and put in a ticket so they have everything set so they know what they're actually looking for. And one thing too, sitting there talking to our new assistant superintendents, I have to applaud Mr. Short for really finding candidates that are going to fit well into the school district. I was very impressed with both of them. One's a little quiet, the other one's a go-getter. Everything's going to click fine. There was one question I did have to ask Dr. Rossi. He's coming from Plum, and I think he still probably might be employed October 7th by Plum because of that 60-day holdover. October 7th is a really big day here at Gateway. Gateway plays Plum, and I did ask him what color he will be wearing to the game. And he did. I don't know if it was because we were, like, interviewing. He did say black and gold. So that's what swayed a lot of us. But on
he did say his two children who attend the schools here at Gateway refuse to allow anything purple. With purple and gold in the household. So rest assured it will be black and gold now.
But good luck to all the teachers, staff, students, and parents with the start of school. And Mr. Short, it's in your ball game now.
We're ready
so
to go.
Best of luck. That's it for tonight.
Thank you. Oh, Mr. Lepsovich.
She took a few words out of my mouth, but Mr. Washington, you were overdue, and I'm very glad the board agreed with the sporting authority or whatever heck you want to call us that you deserved. And Randy, thank you for the backing of the other sports. And I was watching on TV the other night, The Most Wanted. And I just happened to look up, and I see a picture above me on the bulletin board. And I swear to God, he was the most wanted. So if anybody knows who this gentleman is, please notify our president of the board, and we'll get this situation under control.
Thank you,
Stephanie? I would just like to say congratulations to Alex Portis. He's a Gateway student and resident for his In Monroeville magazine photo shoot and article. It's really impressive that he made it onto national TV with his baking expertise, and it's exciting that he's opening his own business. Next, I would also like to welcome Dr. Chakey, and Dr. Rossi. I'm very excited to see what they'll bring to the table. I'm sure we're going to see a lot of nice changes in Gateway, especially academically with their expertise in curriculum, and give Mr. Short a little bit of a break since he's been working overtime. Also, I would like to say I saw the student enrollments, and I think it's great that some of our class sizes are getting larger, but I hope to say as a board member that we will hire teachers if need be, if the class sizes get too large.
How much is it
going to
cost?
We are truly monitoring this. When I say daily,
okay.
There are, when I walk down the steps from the second floor to the first, there are families literally walking in today. They will be walking in the next week. And if we need to make adjustments, recommendations, we will do so quickly to the board. because we do know that class sizes, once they reach a certain level, can impact or impede learning.
All right, thank you. Mm-hmm. And welcome back to all students and staff. I'm excited for another year at Gateway as a parent, especially. Summer's coming to an end, and that's all.
Thank you, Steph. Mr. O'Donnell.
How many folks are here in support of lacrosse? Just okay. Well, it's pretty, thank you. It's pretty clear, I want to make it clear, that I'm a huge supporter of lacrosse, have always been a huge supporter of lacrosse, and perhaps John, you could, after the meeting, explain to me what lacrosse is. I want to report on the GAP committee. The GAP committee has been meeting religiously. Four members of this board are on that committee. We are moving towards a set of recommendations to present to this board. We would hope to be able to do that in the not too distant future. They have been spirited, enlightening, engaging discussions that have been attended by the press in some instances and by Neil Nola and others, and we appreciate that. So it's going along well, and I think we're going to be able to recommend some concrete pathways towards closing the achievement gap here at Gateway.
Along with some third-party input, our new assistant superintendent.
Yes.
Has some valuable
very valuable, yeah. And then finally, I just want to mention that although we sound like we might bicker a bit up here over, what did I say, Neil? 0.0, whatever. We all go out for a beer afterwards together. So you guys shouldn't leave thinking, oh my God, these guys are terrible. And I want to stress to, because so many folks have come out, that this board spends a lot more time focusing on quality education than it does anything else. And we're committed to sports and we're committed to a lot of important things. But education, Mr. Yacom, is job one here. That's clear from each and every board member. And I appreciate working with people who share that value. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mr. O'Donnell. Mr. Nola.
I don't have much. I just wanted to say, it may have sounded like I was a little bit touchy here on some of these subjects today. And that's not really the case, actually. I just wanted to get us more focused on the procedures that we have to follow and go through, because I think that we are the representatives of the school, and others are probably looking at us so that we can show them how you follow these procedures and how you get to good outcomes and how you make good decisions. That's all I was trying to do with our thing. But that being said, I want to assure everybody, just like Mr. O'Donnell just said, everybody, especially on the board and the administrators, the amount of time and energy and dedication that they put in is phenomenal. I mean, like the board people, they're not getting paid, and they put in hours and hours on sometimes on every issue and sometimes on their specific issues that they're talking about. And I for one, totally appreciate it, and I hope everybody in the community appreciates it, because there's a lot of effort. And like Mr. O'Donnell said, we may sound like we're bickering or not. I consider all these folks my friends, actually. And so I just want everybody to know that we are dedicated to making Gateway the best school district in the world, period.
Thank you, Neil.
I'm going to drop the mic.
I will try to stay brief since I'm sweating. I'm sure everyone else is sweating. We've been here a very long time. So. As far as lacrosse goes, again, I think the biggest statistic that stood out to me last year was the second highest GPA. I mean, honestly, you guys should be very impressed with that. I know I personally am. That's quite an accomplishment. We have a lot of great athletic teams that have a lot of scholar athletes. So if some of the really smart ones graduated, you guys might need to pick it up a little bit. But I'd like to see you guys up there again as well. So as far as the funding and everything goes, again, there are some adults up here bickering. I know I don't look much as an adult. I'm probably closer to your kid's age than your age. But I would say that, you know, this dialogue is really what has helped us this year achieve a balanced budget, really move forward, concentrate on academics, cut some of the fat out of the budget so that we can really restore Gateway to academic excellence. So, yes, there is a lot of bickering that occurs. There's even more that occurs outside, you know, come to the budget meetings, and those are very long meetings. I don't wish them upon anyone. But those conversations really do help to move us forward. So with that, I think everyone here, well, the vote was 9-0, so everyone here is in support of the program. We look forward to seeing the program move forward, but obviously there are some things budgetary-wise that we just want to make sure are followed. For anyone in the press, and I know there's two of you here today, both wrote articles on 10 teachers being furloughed from Gateway. I hope that an equal article will be written that all 10 teachers were brought back from being furloughed. So I think that the administration and the school board has done a great job of actually bringing back all 10 teachers that were furloughed. So every June, it's going to, every local paper will say, so many teachers furloughed. So legally, we actually have to give a furlough letter if there's any chance that teacher may be furloughed. So it looks bad, right? It said 10 teachers furloughed from Gateway front page. But all 10 teachers have come back to the district. So I do just want to throw that out to the public.
Compromising programs, education.
Yeah, not one educational program was affected. All 10 teachers mm-hmm. have come back. So as you see us bickering about $8,000 for sports, mind you, all educators are back in the budget. And I do want to thank mm-hmm. Bill and everyone for doing a great job of making that happen and making sure the programs were not affected in any way. Mm-hmm. As far as Guy Rossi and Dennis Chakey go, congratulations to the two of them. Hopefully we can steal them quicker than 60-day allotment. As far as Guy and specific, when I was going door-to-door 3 years ago, one of the biggest complaints I heard was, you know, these people don't have a vested interest. You know, people from school board have to live here, but our administrators don't live here. A lot of our teachers don't live here. This is a guy that's lived in the district for 16 years. He definitely has a vested interest. He has two children in the district. So I do just want to point that out to the public. And to me, that is huge, you know, because when he goes to his kids' baseball games and he goes to events, trust me, he's going to be hearing it. But I just think that is huge, and I think that's going to be a great contribution to the district moving forward. I want to say, everyone, just drive safely. The students will be out at bus stops, hopefully. So just watch out early in the morning when you're going to work and also coming back from work for students out there. As you can see, Mrs. Warning gave us all these little light-up pins, so if you're being blinded by those, that's what those are. Other than that, I just want to say thank you, everyone who showed up. Obviously, again, lacrosse is a great program. Please feel free to reach out in advance with any questions, concerns on any issues. I know athletic issues tend to draw a lot of people coming to the meetings, but with any issues in the district, please feel free to reach out. We are here for you. and I do respond, so feel free to reach out. But with that, I will seek a motion for adjournment.
So moved. Second.
Motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing one, motion passes.
Aye.